Welcome to Hindu Analysis, July 31st, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is Leg Up for Private Sector Participation in Defense Equipment Manufacturing. So what the news is, recently the Defense Acquisition Council, which is headed by the Defense Minister, approved for the implementation of strategic partnership guidelines. So what is this strategic partnership? In the sense, the Defense Ministry is now going to be a partnership with the private sectors so that the private sector participate in the domestic manufacturing of the defense equipments. So this SP model, which is, so this strategic partnership policy came last month itself, but it is delayed due to the lack of the specific guidelines. But now they are coming with this strategic partnership specific guidelines. So according to this SP model, the Defense Ministry is going to join the hands with the private sector. So why means it is for mainly for three purposes. One is to revitalize the defense industrial ecosystem. So if we include private participation in the defense manufacturing, it is going to improve the quality of the defense equipment as well. And the second one is build indigenous capabilities. That means rather than importing the defense equipment from all the countries, now we are tending to make all those things indigenously, which means domestic manufacturing is preferred as of now. So for that, this SP model will help. And also to design, develop and manufacture this complex weapon system, which could be possible only if Defense Ministry joins hands with this or private sector. As of now, according to this new strategic partnership guideline, there are four major equipments are opened up for this private participation. So the one is submarines, the next one is single engine fighter aircraft, the third one is the helicopters, and fourth one is armored carriers or main battle tanks, you see here, right? So these four things are open for the private sector as of now. For submarine, one private sector. For aircraft, one private sector. For helicopter, one private sector. So each and every segment is provided with a separate private sector so that they can give focused attention and timely execution of the manufacturing of the defense equipments. So this DAC, that is this Defense Acquisition Council, also approved two things. The first one is platform specific guidelines, the same guidelines for the procurement of naval utility helicopters. And another one is acquisition of 8 fast patrol vessels for the Coast Guard. So this is indigenous one. So this fast patrol vessels are indigenously manufactured one. So this DAC approved these two things also. What they are going to do in the future is this private sectors or this private participators with our Defense Ministry, right? So they are going to join their hands with shortlisted global equipment manufacturing companies all over the world, and they are under this technology transfer, they are going to get the technology and they are going to apply it indigenously to make our defense equipments. So the Defense Ministry also said that this procurement under the SP model or the strategic partnership model is going to be executed under a specially constituted body, which is the Empowered Project Committee. So the second article is LCA clearance may take time. So this is about LCA, which is the light combat aircraft, which is Tejas. So this is indigenous. This Tejas is indigenous, lightweight, as well as multi-role aircraft. So this one is a multi-role and lightweight aircraft, this Tejas is. So it is also powered by GE-404 engine. Okay. So what the news here is, for any defense equipments or for any military equipments, what actually needed is IOC and FOC, which is initial operational clearance and final operational clearance. So for any aircraft to be inducted into the Indian Air Force, they need two major things. One is the initial operational clearance and final operational clearance. So only if you get these clearances, then the aircraft will be inducted into the Indian Air Force. So as of now, as of July 2018, only 9 aircrafts have been inducted into the Indian Air Force, which is very less than what they actually estimated. Because if you see the data, the Indian Air Force signed 2 contracts with the Hindustan Aeronautic Limited. According to that, the first IOC should be like, it was signed in 2006, and 20 aircraft should be inducted within 2011. So this was the first contract plan. The second contract plan is 2010 it was signed. So according to this, the final after getting the final operational clearance for those aircrafts, again 20 new aircrafts should be inducted to the Indian Air Force by 2016. But in reality, only 9 aircrafts have been inducted into the Indian Air Force as of now. So The news here is this Tejas to be inducted into the Indian Air Force, that is, should be done within this December 2018. But the reality, in real scenario, it is not possible. So it is likely to slip. This is what the news is. That means it is going to take 6 more months for the process to be get entirely completed. Why? Because the aircraft or the Tejas, the 9 Tejas aircraft, which is now inducted into the Indian Air Force, that is, have the capability of these things. That means that can do all these things like undertaking air defense operations, conventional ground attack with the heavy bombs. So these can all be done by this inducted Tejas aircraft. But what they further need to test is these things, which means the gun firing of the Tejas aircraft, air-to-air refueling between these aircrafts, and the new data linked software defined radios. So these are all the things that yet to be tested for the Tejas aircraft. Only after testing all these things, the final operational clearance will be given to those Tejas aircraft, and it will be finally getting inducted into the Indian Air Force. So the third article is a balancing act. So recently there have been certain amendments be brought by the Parliament to the Prevention of Corruption Act. These are all the amendments. So if you see, the first three are the amendments under this Prevention of Corruption Act, which raising concerns for the citizens. And last one is a welcome amendment. So the first amendment is, it mandates the prior government approval of central and the state government, which means before, if any public official, especially in the higher range of public official like the joint secretary and all, if you are going to arrest them under this Corruption Act, then prior approval from the central government or the state government is needed to start the investigation itself or to put the case against them, to file the case against them. The prior approval is recommended or needed. But now what they change here is this prior government approval is expanded or is extended to all the public officials. So it is a major concern because it is acting like a blanket to all the public officials to hide under if at all they are committing this corruption, as well as it is a time-taking process. So the second amendment, which is the deletion of 13(1)(d) section of this Prevention of Corruption Act. So this deletion, what it means is, it deleted this major thing, which is the criminal misconduct as the acquisition of a valuable thing or pecuniary advantage in a dishonest manner. So if a public official or authority is going to acquisit some valuable thing or the pecuniary advantage in a dishonest manner, if they are acquiring something or corrupting, so then they are obviously coming under this section 13(1)(d). But now they eliminate this whole 13(1)(d), so which is again a major concern because they are not coming under this ambit of getting these kind of valuable things or getting the bribe. So it sets them free, right? I mean, this deletion of this section 13(1)(d) liberates the public officials so that there might be a chance that they may indulge in these kind of activities in the future. So the third amendment is incorporation of income received from any lawful activity. So they newly inserted these thing into the Prevention of this Corruption Act. So under this also, this lawful source means what? They are not clearly defined what is this lawful source means, which means if you are getting some money from illegal way, or if you are getting the money from a source which is hidden or unknown, and if you pay taxes for that money, then it will become legal. So this is also a major concern. And the final one is the welcome amendment, which is a positive amendment, which is appreciated by most of the people, is the criminal misconduct of the Corruption Act is now extended to the bribe giver also. So not only the bribe taker, but also the bribe giver is also coming under this Prevention of Corruption Act now. So it is a good thing because it is not like the public officials or the authorities are always involving in these kind of corruption activities. We the people, to get our work done in a very faster way, we can also sometimes tend to give bribe to the public officials, so we should also be punished, right? So this is a welcome move, because including this bribe giver under the ambit of this Prevention of Corruption Act is a welcome move. The next article is the narrow and the transformative. So this article majorly talks about the approach of the Supreme Court towards each and every cases, like political case, how it approach, economic case, how it approach, and if it is a cultural case, how it approach, whether it is open to all these cases in a similar way, or it constrained itself to a specific cases. So these are all the things which we are going to see in this article. So if you see the cases which have been dealt by the Supreme Court this year, the first half of the Supreme Court cases mostly dealt with Aadhaar hearings, which means under Aadhaar Act, they are collecting the informations of the citizens or data of the citizens. So which is again coming under the concern that whether it affects the privacy of the individual in the country. So this is a case which is mostly occupied the first half of the year of the Supreme Court. So the second half of the Supreme Court's cases mostly dealt with three major cases. One is Section 377. The second one is Sabarimala case, and third one is this adultery case. So the first Section 377 case, this is concluded one. So the Supreme Court has given its verdict. And the second one, the Sabarimala case, is an ongoing process. And the third, adultery, is a scheduled one. That means it has to be dealt in the future. So now we are going to see all these three cases. So if you see what kind of scenarios each and every case approaches, so this Section 377 of Indian Penal Code, it criminalizes the homosexual activities, which is against the order of nature. So it is a personal right issue of each and every individual in the country. And if you see in case of Sabarimala, it is like a case which is dealing with the cultural and religious rights of the groups or the societies prevailing in the country. So if you see about this adultery issue, so it is deals with the social institutions of our society like marriage. So each and every case deals with different perspective of our society. So how the Supreme Court approaches each and every cases is different. So now we are going to see how they are going to approach, how they approach all these cases before. So normally what the Supreme Court does is, the state, if at all, make use of the laws or the constitutional provisions which are available for its own purposes, or if the state misuse it or breach the constitutional provisions, then the Supreme Court comes and interferes and strike down the offending law. So normally what the Supreme Court does is, if the state is going to make use of any laws or constitutional provisions for its own use, or if suppose it misuse the laws or provisions or breach the laws, then the Supreme Court comes and interferes and strike down those laws. So this is what happening usually. That means this is for universal cases, like for example, Section 66A of IT Act. But what actually happened is, by making use of this 66A of the IT Act, lot of innocent peoples are getting arrested under this hate speech. This is universal problem because it is affecting the fundamental right of the citizens in the country. So each and every individual should be provided with the right to freedom of expression, freedom of speech, everything. But if it obstructs that, then obviously the Supreme Court comes and struck down this 66A of the IT Act. Similarly, so anything which is universal and anything which is wanted by each and every people of the society, then the Supreme Court can involve in a full way. So if it is a cultural issue, then there arises a conflict of interest between two or more groups. So here it involves the rights of each and every group also. So on dealing these kind of cultural issues, the Supreme Court has to be take a balanced stand, not this kind of full open thing. So this is what they are telling in this article. So if you see here, the framers of our Indian Constitution, instead of this uniform civil code, instead of putting this or inserting this uniform civil code under fundamental right, they are putting it under directive principles of state policy. Fundamental rights are enforceable. Directive principles of state policy are non-enforceable. So why they are putting it under this DPSP is, uniform civil code means the code which is common to all the civil people or all the society. So discard or regardless of what their culture is, what their caste, what their religion, so whatever it is. So if what is this uniform civil code means, the code which is common to all the civil society people, regardless of what their religion is, caste is, or communities, whatever, what their interest or whatever their rights is, this uniform civil code is similar. So if this uniform civil code is to be inserted in the fundamental right, then it should be enforced, which is not equal to all the, which is not acceptable by every community. So only they are putting it in the DPSP, which is non-enforceable. So this is one point of view why they take a balanced stand in this cultural perspective. Similarly, the political parties are also maintaining equilibrium while dealing with these kind of cultural cases. So unlike the Supreme Court deals with these political or economical dispute cases, if in case of cultural cases, the Supreme Court usually tend to take a balanced view. Why? Because if it is going to take some decisions based on the available materials, So if the Supreme Court is going to take some decisions based on the constitutional provisions, even though it is good in one perspective, it is favorable for one community and it is unfavorable for certain other community, which ultimately led to the erosion of faith towards the Supreme Court by that certain community. So only to deal with this partial erosion of faith or to deal with this partial favoritism of the Supreme Court towards a community, they always tend to take a balanced view. So in this case, the Supreme Court is taking two kind of approaches. One is the narrow approach as well as the transformative approach. So what the narrow approach in the sense, it is not like the court avoid the hearing or it is not raising any kind of constitutional questions or it refrain itself from expressing any opinion. So it is not like that. So it is stating what it is needed actually. So if you see in case of section 377, the court limit itself to simple decriminalization of the section 377, which means it simply tells this homosexual, which is against the nature, is decriminalized. It is not a criminal act. That is what they tell, nothing more than that. So it limits its ambit. Similarly, in Sabarimala case, it tells like rule which exceeds the scope of the parent law, which means the constitutional provisions are prevailing more than, or that the fundamental rights are prevailing more than the parent law, which is the religious law. So this is what they tell while declaring the Sabarimala case verdict. So these kind of the things are narrow approaches which is followed by the Supreme Court. So the second one is the transformative approach by the Supreme Court. So constitution is a transformative document, which means it is an evolving document. Whatever the provisions which we are having in 1950, it is not similar as what we have now. So our rights are evolving. Similarly, this constitution should also get evolved. So if you see in case of section 377, so the LGBT community is socially excluded for a very longer period of time. So it is a longer issue, but now our rights as it is evolving, the Supreme Court now come and decriminalizes the section 377, which ensures the rights for this LGBT community. Similarly, the Sabarimala issue, in that the women are not allowed inside the temple for a very longer period of time based on some cultural values or something, but now they are again, the Supreme Court is taking some transformative approach. Now they are allowing the women to enter into the Sabarimala temple. So which is also proving that the Supreme Court is taking some transformative approach while considering or approaching these kind of cultural cases. So the next article is a good beginning on draft data protection bill. So the draft legislation on the data protection is drafted by Justice B.N. Sri Krishna to MeitY, which is the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. So it is basically to speedily build some India's legal framework for the data protection. So vast amount of data which is collected by the private companies as well as the state agencies from the citizens are circulated all over the country. So what the deep concern here is, this absence of any kind of legal framework for the protection of the citizens' data is a major concern now. So that is why Justice B.N. Sri Krishna to MeitY proposed this new draft legislation for the protection of the data of the citizens. So what is a major provision under this data protection bill is, it codifies the relationship between the individuals who are us with the states who are collecting the data from us. So the data principals are the people who are giving the data to the state agencies or the private companies, and the data fiduciaries are the people or the companies who are collecting actually the data from the people. So under this article, what they're actually doing is they put the onus on the data fiduciary, which means they put the responsibility on the private companies or the state agencies who are collecting the data from the people. So they put the responsibility there, which means they should get the prior permission or they should get the prior consent from the individuals before they are processing the data or before they are making use the data. So this draft data protection bill, right? So this is looking similar to the data protection regulation, which is recently adopted by the European Union this May month. So according to that, the data principals, who are the people who are giving the data, so they have the rights to confirmation, they have the right to correct the data, they have the portability of the data, and they also have the rights to be forgotten about their data from the private companies or whoever getting collected the data. So under the new data protection bill, they supposed to create a regulatory data protection authority of India. Under this bill, there is a provision which actually exempted the state institutions, which means the state institution should not require to get the consent from the individuals before processing the data. So this raises a major concern among the people. Similarly, the report also recommends the parliamentary oversight as well as the judicial approval for the non-consensuous access to the personal data, which means the judiciary should come and play its role to ensure that the rights of the individuals be preserved. The next article is Draft National Registrar of Citizen in Assam. Yesterday, the draft NRC was published by the Registrar General of India in Guwahati. So in that NRC list, 40 lakh people are out of the NRC list among the 3.29 crore applicants who are applied for the citizenship. So among the 40 lakh people, 2.48 lakh people are doubtful voters. So this is what they declared. So the Home Ministry also ensured that there is an ample opportunity be provided to those 40 lakh people to prove their citizenship. So the name of the applicants who are left out of those NRC list is also not revealed in order to protect their privacy. So this is what the Home Ministry told. So now we are going to see what these things one by one. Who is this D voter means? D voter is dubious voter or doubtful voter. So any person who is not having any valid citizenship credentials are now treated as the D voter. Who is a declared foreigner means if these D voters, these 40 lakh D voters, right? So they, if they approach the foreign tribunals in Assam and if they fail to approve that their citizenship of Assam, then they are treated as the foreigner. So why is NRC being updated in Assam? Why they are updating means? So specifically to root out the foreigners, which means especially to address the problem of illegal migrants from the Bangladesh into Assam. So to remove them, they are actually updating this NRC. So why is this March 24, 1971 is a cutoff date? Means many migration were happened before also from Bangladesh to Assam, but the biggest migration was happened only during this 1971 when the Pakistan army cracked down. A lot of people flee from Bangladesh into the Assam. So that is why this date is fixed as a cutoff date. So who is a citizen in Assam? So the Citizenship Act of 1955. So it was amended after the Assam Accord. According to that, any person who is coming from Bangladesh after 1966, so he was if he was a person of Indian origin, then he was treated as the citizen of Assam. Similarly, before 1966, if he is a person of Indian origin, then he is treated as a citizen. And if 1966 to 1971, if he came from Bangladesh and acquired or naturalized the citizenship and stayed here for a period of 10 years, then he is also considered as a citizen of the Assam state. But after 1971, if he comes, then he is supposed to be deported from the Assam state. So this is what the plan which they are following. So what happens to this excluded 40 lakh people from the NRC list means they can approach the foreign tribunals in Assam and they can make their claims and objections over there and they try to prove their citizenship there. And it is extended up to September 30. So they have a vast amount of time. So the next article is citizenship by investment, which means a person becomes a naturalized citizen of any country if he is going to invest in that country. So this is what this economic citizenship means or citizenship by investment means. So if you are going to a country and invest in the country, then you have the right to acquire the citizenship of that country. So why this news is? A fugitive diamondeer, his name is Mehul Choksi. So he had acquired citizenship of Antigua and Barbuda, which is a Caribbean island, recently before the CBI filed a case against him for this allegation of the PNB fraudulent case. So this concept of gaining the citizenship without even residing in the country is first started by St. Kitts and Nevis, which is an island. So if you give or if you invest like $150,000 in this island, then you get the, then you have the option to get the citizenship of that country. Similarly, in Antigua and Barbuda, if you are giving $100,000, you have the option to get the citizenship. Similarly, in US, if you are investing like $1,000,000, then you obviously have the option to acquire the citizenship of US. So India also offers the same kind of thing if at all any foreigners come and invest here. So these are all represents the economic citizenship. So the next article is stem cells trial to fight the Parkinson's diseases. So what this Parkinson's disease is, it is a chronic neurological disease which affects the body's motor system, which destabilizes the normal body movement. So recently, the researchers plan to inject 5 million induced pluripotent stem cells into the patient's brain in order to treat this Parkinson's diseases. This is for the first time the researchers have made use of this induced pluripotent stem cells for the Parkinson's diseases. Before also they make use of these stem cells for treating blood cancer, immunal disorders, etc. But this is the first time for Parkinson's diseases. How they are going to do here is the normal cell of the adult body is taken first and it is changed into this induced pluripotent stem cell. How means? So this normal adult cell is now treated with embryo-induced gene in order to make this into an induced pluripotent stem cells. So now this induced pluripotent stem cells is used or making use to treat this Parkinson's diseases. So in presently 10 million people are affected by this Parkinson's diseases worldwide. So if you see here, that is what, as we already said, this iPS cells are created by simulating the mature cells from the adult body to back to a juvenile state by means of inducing this embryo-induced gene. And one positive aspect of this iPS cells which is induced into the body is not transformed into any tumors, so it is a positive thing. This procedure of iPS is looking similar to the cloning process, but it is different. Though this process looks similar to the cloning process, in cloning process there is a transfer of nucleus, but here in this iPS there is a transfer of gene. This success trial of the iPS shows a way that this can be used in the future for treating other diseases also.